Okay, if I could ask those leaving the public gallery and indeed leaving the chamber to do so as quickly and as quietly as possible as we move on to the next item of business, which is a member's business debate on motion 7249 in the name of Emma Roddick on UK income inequality. The debate will be concluded without any questions being put, so I'd invite members who wish to participate to press the request to speak buttons now or as soon as possible. I call on Ms Roddick to open the debate for around 7 minutes, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and I'm grateful to those who supported my motion to allow it to be debated today and give us the opportunity to discuss this Financial Times analysis, because it covers such an important issue and one that is not given enough attention. I think in the hustle and bustle of everyday politics and the headlines, we often forget to step back and look at the big picture. And I hope folk will do that just for a moment, putting aside COVID, Brexit, strikes, to look at the UK as a whole and how it is functioning. We are living in a country whose governments have long made public policy designed to help the rich get richer, to promote endless private economic growth at the expense of looking after its citizens. We are living in an extremely unequal society where the richest can enjoy a good life and the worst off are in dire poverty, more likely to experience serious health issues and require significant support needs. It's perhaps harder to see because those in the public eye, celebrities, high earners, MPs with fortunate backgrounds, can seem to represent the UK in more than just TV interviews, but they do not. Financial Times analysis last year described the UK more accurately as a poor society with some very rich people in it. Another accurate description can be found in Dick Gawkins' lyrics, "They make the laws to serve them well and feed the rich while poor men starve." That is the hard truth. Half of the people in this country account for 9% of the wealth, and Conservative governments do their best to ensure that that gap keeps getting bigger. This is normal to us, but it is not normal. The same Financial Times analysis found that the poorest Irish household has a standard of living almost 63% higher than the poorest in the UK. Other younger nations like Slovenia are also likely to, from next year, have a higher average standard of living than us. And the message I want to get out there is that there are better ways forward than what we are used to. There are alternative economic ideologies to conservatism, and we can redistribute wealth so that nobody has to experience extreme poverty. There are examples of alternatives across Europe, and there's also a clear one presented in the Scottish Government's Building a New Scotland papers. We could be more like European neighbours such as Sweden, Ireland, Finland, Denmark, who use their full powers to achieve a fairer society as well as economic success. Being taken out of Europe against the wishes of the Scottish electorate has led my region of the Highlands and Islands to lose out on funding we previously relied on for projects that improved the economy of rural and island communities, as well as the lives of the people living in them. The replacement funding that we've seen so far has fallen far short of what we used to get and far short of what Whitehall promised. There's a big lie that we're taught that the huge gap between the richest and poorest in this society is a necessary side effect of having a healthy economy. And firstly, I would argue that's not a worthwhile sacrifice in the first place. But secondly, it is not even true. Conservative capitalist policies have resulted in an unequal society and the UK being the only country in the G7 forecast to have negative growth, worse than Russia, which has been facing international sanctions for almost a year. I've always found that people will try to put those of us who didn't grow up learning about stocks and shares and didn't study PPE at Oxbridge off debating financial policy, using buzzwords and talking about the businesses they've run, investment funds, using frames of reference that are so far removed from what most of us will ever experience that it seems like there's no room in the debate for those on the left. But there is. Because even if you believe that a more socialist approach to public spending would crash the economy, I have to ask at this point, what have you got to lose? Because conservative and neoliberal capitalist policies have just crashed the economy. Let's give something else a try. Successive Tory UK governments have historically fixed or more accurately covered up cash flow issues that they like to pretend don't exist under conservatism by selling off public services. But the problem with that is that once you've sold off the Royal Mail, you can't sell it off again. And all it's done is gift future governments the issue of having to deal with private interests running roughshod over workers' rights, with ministers no longer able to force changes to paying conditions and having nobody but its own institution to blame. People deserve a government that will do better than that, that will acknowledge issues and tackle them rather than pretend it's not happening. Most people, whether they're personally managing or not, do not want to live in a country where kids grow up hungry and in poverty when there's no need for it. Most want public services to be run in the interests of the public, not private shareholders. Most are happy to pay their share to make sure that they don't live in that kind of country. And that's what we have to remember when we are making decisions here on things like taxes, like the Scottish Government has done this year by asking those on the highest incomes to pay 1p more on their top rate of tax. Taxes are not like giving to charity. Living in a civilised society where opportunity is available to everyone isn't, or certainly shouldn't be, a charity case. I don't want to go out and ask rich folk to consider giving money to the cause of people not being left destitute because they needed to access what should be a public service free at the point of need. That's why taxes are not optional. They are the price of living in a country that provides you with security and public services, and I'm personally happy to pay a lot more in tax than someone earning what I used to earn 3 years ago for the sake of the Scottish Government being able to pay money to kids growing up in poverty. The Scottish Government is doing more than any other administration in the UK to help those who need it most and reduce inequality, introducing measures like the Scottish Child Payment, unique in the Four Nations, and working on proposals for a minimum income guarantee. Imagine what more we could do with the powers of independence. Because we have everything it takes to become a successful, fair, internationalist nation, apart from not being tied to a Westminster that brings us Brexit, cost of living crises, and austerity. The UK economy is not strong and stable. It hasn't got broad shoulders. It is failing the people of Scotland. The opposition will continue to criticise us for highlighting these facts, but people need to know. People deserve to know why the promises of prosperity and opportunity never appear, and they need to know how much fairer other countries, which are doing what the SNP wants to do, are. If other countries in Europe can tackle inequality through independence in Europe, why not Scotland? Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Robert. We now move to the open debate. I first call Edward Mountain to be followed by Kyle Mochan. Around 4 minutes, Mr. Mountain.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. And I'd like to thank Emma Roddick for bringing this debate. I actually found it quite interesting, a lot of what she was saying. And the cost of living crisis, which she's referred to, is something that we all have to live with. And we should be under no illusions. No one should be under any illusions that this cost of living crisis has been mainly driven by Russia's illegal invasion into Ukraine. It is them that have driven up the prices of electricity. It is them that has driven up the cost of power. It is them that has driven up the cost of fertiliser and the production of all the basic needs in food that we require. I do accept... Can I just get a little bit further, and then, of course, I will give way. I accept there is more to do, which is why I believe that driving down inflation to half of where it is, why we need to grow the economy, why we need to reduce the national debt, and why we need to build our public services, something we should all be concentrating on. I'd happily give way to the member.
Emma Roddick.
I thank the member for giving way, and I totally appreciate the point he's making around electricity costing more. But surely it should be the case that if people are having to pay so much for electricity that they have no money left or are being pushed into debt, it is the job of the UK government to step in and use its powers to regulate that market.
Edward Mountain.
The problem is the UK regulating the UK market doesn't resolve the energy problems and the energy cost. It is a world market which drives it. We can help, and I'll tell you some of the ways that the UK government is helping. I was interested in the article that Emma Roddick quoted, and I think the final paragraph, if I have it here, goes on to say, if I can find it, just here I underlined it, our leaders are, of course, right to target economic growth. That's what we should be doing, growing the economy. And we know that by growing the economy, we can make everyone better and have a better standard of living. And in my mind, you won't be surprised, no, not just at the moment, but I will in a moment, in my mind, that is not something that comes about with independence, where we are building walls which will cut off 60% of our markets. And when we turn, and as the member has suggested, about building a new Scotland, what I wanted to see in those papers, if they were really going to be anything more than fantasy economics, is discussion about who was paying the pensions, what the currency would be, what the borders barriers would be. We don't have those. In fact, what we do know is that within those papers, we're not even doing some of the things that we've said we were going to do, like benefits payments. We've asked the UK government to continue to do that. because the Scottish Government couldn't. And one of the things that we aren't clear about is the cost of independence. In 2014, that was put down merely as a £200 million. We're probably talking about billions and billions of pounds, because we know that £200 million doesn't go far, doesn't even build two ferries. I'll give way to the member.
Jim Fairley.
Thank you, Edward, for giving way to that for that intervention. You mentioned all the things that you think are causing the problems of the UK economy, but Tory Prime Minister John Major told the Westminster Parliament that the UK's exit from the EU was a colossal mistake, and yet your party never identify it.
Through the chair, Mr. Fairley.
Your party never accepts that point. So what would you say about the damage that
through
Brexit
the chair, did? Mr. Fairley. Chair, Edward Mountain.
Presiding officer, through the chair, I think that the Brexit decision was a decision that was taken in a referendum, and that decision was made as a vote, and it was a majority vote, and therefore we should respect the referendum. It's not something I campaigned for, and it's not something that this government really campaigned against. They actually spent more money campaigning in Orkney than they did against Brexit, and that is a fact. So let's look at the things, some of the things that we could do better. I think I'm running out of time, Presiding Officer, as I've taken some interventions. Will you be a little bit...
I can give you a bit of time to...
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. Things that concentrate the minds of people in the Highlands, as far as I can see, is the issues we've discussed this morning, the A9, when it's going to be dualled. You know, at the rate that they're going, Callum's Road on Rassy was a better investment than the A9. In fact, would have been built quicker, because that was just one man who in 10 years built 1.5 miles of road. So we're talking about the A96 still not built. The National Treatment Centre, we're all desperate to see 3,200 people in the Highlands alone waiting for treatment, and they're being told that it could be a 7 years wait. We're waiting for ferries. They're 6 years late. We're waiting for HMP Highland. That's 6 years late. And we're waiting for broadband. Well, we were promised that in 2021. Now, these are the issues that concentrate the minds of the people in the Highland. These are what we should be talking about, not some of the points that Emma Roddick is talking about, which, frankly, is all based around her belief that independence is the only solution. It isn't. There are problems we need to deal with. Let's get on with dealing them. Thank you, Presiding Officer.
Thank you, Mr. Mountain. I now call Carol Mochan to be followed by Paul McLennan. Around 4 minutes, Ms. Mochan.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And can I thank Emma Roddick for bringing the debate to the Chamber? I want to start by welcoming Emma's introduction to her contribution. And the words that stand out and has motivated me probably my entire life is that we live in a poor society with some very rich people. And it is absolutely shocking, the wealth divide across the UK, including in Scotland. Emma Roddick is right to highlight the scale of income inequality in the UK relative to other countries in Europe, and this has undoubtedly, in my view, been exacerbated by the Tory-made cost of living crisis, which has made the poor poorer, whilst multi-millionaires record eye-watering profits. And we cannot get away from that. There is eye-watering profits to be made. There is money in the system. We hear about it every day. And it's something that we must challenge. And in my view, wealth can be redistributed. It should be redistributed. And there are acknowledged ways of doing that in a fair and just, and of course now, green way. Of course.
Audrey Nicholl.
I thank the member for giving way, and I agree with her comments up to now. Earlier this morning, I attended a Wellbeing Economy Alliance event, and there was discussion about the gap between the richest and the poorest in Scotland, but also the opportunities that Scotland has to nurture purposeful business that makes a positive difference to, among other things, our well-being, rather than just putting profits in the pockets of shareholders. Would the member agree that that is a good thing for Scotland, and we should embrace that?
Callum Mochan, I can give you the time back.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And yes, of course, you may know I attended the same meeting, which did give us some really excellent food for thought in terms of how we actually move forward with the economy and the way in which we encourage people, communities, to be part of what we would describe as business, but community wealth building, letting them be in charge of their areas, people will know I am extremely positive about. And the example they gave in North Ayrshire, Joe Cullinane was the council leader there, who took bold steps, in my view, but in his view, he was just being fair about how we run our economies for communities. Deputy Presiding Officer, where I think Emma Roddick and I will disagree is that to reduce income inequality, in my view, the step of leaving the UK is not the answer. I would suggest that by delivering a Labour government at Westminster that would repeal anti-trade union legislation, invest in services and communities and offer fairer jobs to people, I think that would be a better solidarity in terms of looking at how we run the community in the UK. Well-paid jobs where workers, unlike under the current Scottish and UK governments, are treated with the respect I think that they deserve. Indeed, Presiding Officer, before the cost of living crisis, the cost of living in more rural communities was already substantially higher than their urban counterparts. Yet the Scottish Government has continued to do little for those communities. And I think it was highlighted yesterday by Emma Roddick and Fergus Ewing that the Highlands have been deprived of transport links in terms of connectivity around the A9, something that they were promised. I want to also say that,
the member is just about to conclude.
Oh, sorry. Apologies for that. In my view, the Scottish Government has not shown the determination. We've had delays in land reform, poor industrial relations with teachers, lack of movement on regressive taxation such as the council tax. And we know that 20 families in Scotland own as much wealth as 30% of the rest of the population, and it's unacceptable. And I do not believe that the Scottish Government have shown enough will. They have done things around the edges, and that's what we talk about in this Parliament. But I hope that I can get some solidarity in terms of the work we do need to do to make sure that in the Scottish Parliament we do everything that we can do. And I know Emma Roddick and others will know that that is my point here, is that in the Scottish Parliament, if we believe that gap is so unjust, we must at this point in time do everything that we can, and of course fight to get a better economic structure out there in the wider UK and world. Thank you, Presiding Officer.
Thank you, Ms Mochan. I now call Paul McLennan to be followed by Maggie Chapman for around 4 minutes, Mr McLennan.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Can I thank Emma Roddick for bringing forward this important debate this afternoon? Where would you rather live? A society where the rich are extraordinarily rich and the poor are very poor, or one where the rich are merely very well off, but even those in the lowest incomes also enjoy a decent standard of living? That's the opening line from the Financial Times report entitled Britain and the US are poor societies with some very rich people. Research has consistently shown that while most people express a desire for some distance between top and bottom, they would rather live in a considerably more equal society than they do at present. Now, Edward Mountain talked about issues in the here and now, and some valid points. He talked about, obviously, the invasion of Ukraine. But this is about structural, long-term decline of the UK financial model. Let's look at the position the UK finds itself. On present trends, as Emma Roddick mentioned this, the average Slovenian household will be better off and its British counterpart by 2024. And the average Polish family will move ahead before the end of the decade. The analysis also found that the poorest Irish household had a standard of living almost 63% higher than the poorest in the UK. In the most developed countries, such as neighbouring northwestern European states, the distribution of income is relatively equal, with the top 10% earning about three times as much as the bottom 10%. But the income distributions in the UK, like the US, is much less equal, with the top 10% earning almost five times those at the bottom. This is about long-term structural decline. This doesn't happen overnight. It's policy choices by the UK government. The cost of the union that fails Scotland. Now, on Wednesday, we heard Scottish Tories criticise the Scottish government on social security. Whilst the Scottish government were introducing the groundbreaking Scottish Child Payment, the Tories were cutting universal credit. Not one Scottish Tory MSP spoke up against that. Not one. They all sat in silence. So what about our European neighbours? Let's Yeah, of course.
Carol Mochan.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Again, as I hope the member understands, that you know we agree on a lot of points. I wonder if the member would accept that sometimes we do have to have some of the backbenchers in this place stand up to the government if we really want to get the full benefit of the things that we can do in the Scottish Parliament.
Paul McLennan, I can give you the time.
Thank you. I think there's a valid point. I think most of the work that we do in this place is sometimes in committees, and we all raise important issues at that point. And I think that's what we continue to do, and SNP members I know will do that. I want to come back and talk about our European neighbours. So let's look at Norway. For Norway, it's a consistently rosy picture. The top 10% ranks second for all living standards amongst top deciles in all countries. The median Norwegian household ranks second amongst all national averages. And all the way down at the other end, Norway's poorest 5% are the most prosperous bottom 5% in the world. Norway is a good place to live, whether you're rich or poor. Relative to its European peers, UK economic model is increasingly outmoded. Despite our wealth, too many households continue to live in poverty because of UK structural inequalities. Healthy life expectancy is too low in most deprived areas of our country. Tackling the underlying causes of inequality in our society and providing economic opportunity is vital to improve life chances. Now, the clear fact is that Scotland's policy options, and this is where I think that Carol Mochan and I are diverse, it remain constrained by the current devolution settlement and embed features of the prevailing UK market model. And this is, again, is through the policy decisions taken by successive UK governments, which have a significant extent on where we can take our own economic development. Brexit has exacerbated the UK's long-standing structural problems. And Jim Fairley talked on that and on about Mr Major's impact and thoughts on that. Countries of Scotland's size have consistently outperformed the UK across a range of economic measures. They have the ability to thrive in a globalised economy because they have agility in terms to move and direct their own policy choices that are better suited to their own circumstances. Scotland is well positioned to learn from the experience of other nations and use the powers through independence to improve economic, social and environmental outcomes significantly. We have strong business sectors in food and drink, financial services, energy and, of course, in low carbon. We have top world-class universities. Scotland has more universities per million people in the top 200 when compared to the rest of the UK and is ranked third globally behind Switzerland and the Netherlands. Presiding Officer, full control over tax and benefits would help accelerate progress towards the ambitious targets that have been set by the Scottish Parliament for reducing child poverty. The UK inequality gap will grow. It's structurally inbuilt in the UK financial model. There is another way. We don't have to accept UK mediocrity. Thank you.
I now call Maggie Chapman to be followed by Christine Graham, around 4 minutes, Ms Chapman.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and I'm grateful to Emma Roddick for securing this debate. When we've seen global energy corporations record obscene profits, we must discuss the inequalities that ravage our communities. Income distribution in Scotland is hourglass-shaped. Most people earn the minimum wage, or thereabouts, with a small number of people earning fabulously high incomes. Most income is at the bottom and the top of the distribution, with a narrow, or narrower than it should be, middle. The motion points to the reality that the average UK household will be caught by Slovenian households in terms of how well off they are. But the situation is worse than that, indeed. In 2021, the lowest earning bracket of British households was 20% weaker than the equivalent household in Slovenia. So let's think about where wealth comes from. It has two main sources: natural resources that we all should share, and the labour of workers who add value to those natural resources. Natural resources like oil and gas should have benefited all of us while we exploited them. So now we must share the fruits of the renewable revolution. It must make us all richer, not just those rich enough to own energy companies. Wealth, including income for labour, must be shared as equally as possible so we can share those endowments we receive from nature with everyone. As already mentioned this afternoon, John Byrne Murdoch calls the UK a poor country with some very rich people. And the insight of Kate Pickett and Richard Wilkinson make clear unequal societies are worse for everyone. We've seen over the past 10 years how the interests of the super rich have warped our politics. We had austerity, which cut vital spending on services. The bond purchases associated with quantitative easing increased the wealth of the asset holders. Those asset holders were, of course, already the wealthiest in the wealthiest decile. We are now seeing the disastrous impact of 12 years of austerity and underinvestment in public services. But the UK government is okay with that because their wealthy backers got richer. Not only did we have austerity, but Brexit. A Brexit that owes much to the desire of the wealthy to prevent the UK being part of Europe-wide measures to reclaim wealth stemming from the labour of workers and the extraction of resources for the common good. This tax avoidance costs us all dear. And the Brexit has compounded all the failings of the British economy of the past 15 years. Low productivity, skewed wealth distribution and labour shortages. All this is set against the vast evidence from Wilkinson and Pickett that the simplest way to improve the lives of everyone in our country would be to equalise the distribution of wealth and income. The societies that prioritise more equal distribution perform better on all indicators, from health to crime to education. We all want to improve the NHS and schools and make our society safer, but inequality means we are pushing that stone up an ever steeper hill. We know that wealth in the UK is undertaxed. By taxing wealth less, we end up taxing work more, and that is bad for everyone. It's a disincentive to work. It's a key driver of inequality. The UK government, which controls most of the tax powers to tax wealth, must act. And we need to make the case that equality will be at the heart of an independent Scotland. We have to find a way to introduce a pay ratio. In 2022, the FTSE 100 executive pay increased by 23% at a time we were told most ordinary workers will need to take a real terms pay cut. We need to taper pay increases so those on lower incomes catch up with our high earners. And we need genuine action on income in kind. So we need to tax wealth effectively, tackling asset bubbles, radically reforming our local tax system, and so much more. Some things should be done now by the UK government to help us deal with the cost of living crisis we face today. But most of all, we need to recognise that inequality isn't necessary, it isn't healthy, and it is at the root of many of our society's problems. Every step we take to reduce inequality makes our job in creating a better society much easier. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms Chapman. And I call the final speaker in the open debate, Christine Graham, around 4 minutes. Ms Graham.
I think I'm a spontaneous speaker here. I didn't intend to speak, but Edward Mountain really got to me because in talking of the cost of living crisis, yes, there's a contribution from Putin's war. There is a contribution from COVID. But why did Edward Mountain sidestep Liz Truss' disastrous economic policies and Brexit, where 62% of Scotland sensibly voted Remain, and no doubt that's higher now? Practically every economist tells us that Brexit exacerbated the current situation, including Mark Carney, former governor of the Bank of England, hardly Scottish nationalists. And I say to Carol Moughlin, who's a heartfelt, I'm a socialist as well, but I've lived through too many Labour governments, starting out with Harold Wilson, that's how far I go back, then James Callaghan, the winter of discontent, Tony Blair, an illegal war that cost lives and millions, and then we go back to Gordon Brown and the Black Banks collapse. And in each of these governments, I can see no distinction between that and the Conservatives, because the rich got richer and the poor got poorer. Then I saw the light, and I decided that Scotland could make a better fist of it itself. You may.
Carol Moughlin.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Thank you to Christine Graham for taking that intervention. I wonder if Christine Graham might just mention some of the things that Labour governments have done. I think it is only fair to acknowledge, in terms of the way in which we treat workers, the reason that we have good terms and conditions, all of those things were done by Labour governments. And I think it would only be fair for her to acknowledge that the SNP don't do everything that they commit to. So I would like a bit of a...
The big difference for us is we don't have macroeconomic powers in here. We have a handout in the Barnett Consequentials from the UK government, and that limits us, but we mitigate. And we should be mitigating policies that we don't agree with. Why we're bringing the child payment... Is this an intervention, Mr Mountain? Well, I'm delighted.
Edward Mountain.
Thank you very much. It's always nice to acknowledge that you've made mistakes. Do you want to address the ferries and the cost on that? Do you want to address the A9?
Through the
chair.
Through the chair.
And, sorry, would the member like to address the issue with the ferries? Would the member like to address the issues with the A9? Would the member like to address address the issues with the A96. I'd love to hear them. They're her government's favourite.
Christine Graham.
Somehow that didn't actually relate to what I was saying about not having macroeconomic powers, but I'll let you bleat on about those again. Can I just say something else here about it? In my generation, post-war, there was more mobility, I say to Carol Mauchline, for my generation than there is now. And with that, I agree with her. I started out in a prefab, then to a council house, oldest of five children, very working class. From that, I was the first in my street, the girl, to stay in school beyond 15. We were supposed to leave school at 15, get married early. Then after that, I was the first to go to university, and so on. I don't see that mobility in these areas anymore. I think we now have silos where people are trapped by the system, the economic system, and a warped taxation system we have now. So the people suffering now from inflation are ordinary people, whether we call them middle or working class. They're bearing the burden. They're not the millionaires who can put their money offshore and keep it safe somewhere. They can afford to heat their houses and still eat in posh places. You know the only growth industry I see just now from UK government, that's food banks. And even some Tory politicians I know have the temerity to attend and celebrate the opening of a food bank. Disgraceful. We shouldn't have food banks in Scotland.
Thank you, Ms. Graham. I now invite Tom Arthur to respond to the debate. Minister, around 7 minutes, please.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer, and can I begin by thanking Emma Roddick for bringing this important debate to the Chamber, and indeed thanking everyone for their contribution. I think, as Emma Roddick was very eloquently highlighted it, where we all recognise that we do have immediate and pressing priorities, particularly as we face the cost crisis, it is important to lift our heads up and to consider the larger picture. I believe that sincerely for a number of reasons, not just because it's the responsibility, but ultimately, so many of the social ills that we must confront are ultimately driven by and reflections of our underlying economic system. And this was a point that was highlighted, I think, very eloquently as well by Paul McClellan in his speech. And I think he was absolutely correct to focus on the structure. Because when I consider our economic model that we have at the moment, I think I was struck, and it was a reflection I had listening to contributions, that is almost an analogy between our economic model and the actual nature of devolution. We have an economic model which leads to significant negative externalities, to use the jargon, but consequences that are social and environmental, and then it is up through redistribution and mitigation to address these issues, when in reality what we would want is an economic system which pre-distributes, which brings parity between economic, social and environmental factors, a genuine well-being economy, just as we would want a constitutional arrangement whereby the role of the Scottish Parliament was not one whereby it had to mitigate and address the consequences of actions to the best of its ability, but are ultimately driven by policy decisions taken at Westminster. And I think it's important to reflect on that point. I'm conscious that sometimes in arguments and debates concerning the Constitution, opponents of independence or constitutional change would wish to characterise constitutional debate as arcane, recondite, esoteric, something not grounded in reality and of practical relevance to the people of Scotland. Well, people with longer memories and those who have read their history, and people who were there, people like Christine Graham, will remember a time when that was the very charge and very criticism levelled against proponents of establishing this place, that this was not relevant to the priorities of the people of Scotland, that this was not focusing on the day-to-day bread and butter issues. Well, let's just consider the reality, Presiding Officer, because since 2017, the poorest 10% of households in Scotland will see their incomes increase by £580, 4.6 per year, compared to the rest of the UK, while the richest 10% will see their incomes fall by just over £2,500. And amongst the poorest 30%, reforms in Scotland to the income tax and benefit system are set to raise the incomes of households with children by around £2,000 per year on average. And that is the reality of what devolution has been able to bring, a material improvement to the economic circumstances of the individuals we are charged and honoured to serve. Now, my view is that we can go beyond that, and that is a point that Emma Roddick highlighted and what we have sought to articulate through the Building a New Scotland series. Not that independence in and of itself offers a panacea or a silver bullet or an overnight fix, but it equips us with the tools to fundamentally change how our economy operates in a way that is pragmatic, focused, realistic and done in partnership with public, private, third sector interests and communities. And on that, we are taking action where we can. Last week, I launched a government's consultation on community wealth building, and I welcome the reference to community wealth building within the chamber, because that is a means to rewire how our local and regional economies operate. And I want to commend the work that has taken place under multiple administrations now in North Ayrshire, and indeed the way in which the community wealth building model has been incorporated within the wider Ayrshire region. I also want to recognise the excellent work that's been on across the five pilot areas that the Scottish Government has been supporting. And I would encourage all members to engage with the community wealth building consultation process. The reality is that we do not have currently the powers within this Parliament to do everything I would like to do to advance community wealth building, but that should not be a barrier or an impediment to our ambition, and we should be bold. And I really, really want to encourage members to engage, and if members have ideas about how we can take community wealth building forward, to get in touch with me, because this does have the means to effect real, lasting reform at the local level, which in aggregate can accumulate to change at the national level, and as a practical means of delivering on the aspirations of a well-being economy. But, Presiding Officer, what we need is a situation where we can make that change permanent and lasting, as long as there is consent for it in Scotland. And one of the enduring frustrations I have had as a citizen, as an MSP and as a minister is the reality that political positions where there is consensus in Scotland cannot be achieved and effected because of the current constitutional arrangements. Now, Carol Mockin is correct to highlight that Labour governments have delivered progressive policies that have been of benefit to people at a UK level. From Attlee to Wilson, and indeed from 1997 onwards. But reality is, if we look at the legacy that Labour would seek to adduce in favour of the argument for a future Labour government around investment within the NHS, around child poverty, think of what has taken place in the last 13 years since the coming to power of first a Conservative and Liberal government and then a majority Conservative government. A government of which there has not been democratic consent for in Scotland. And Scotland, I recognise, is part of the United Kingdom, but it is also an ancient nation. It is a recognised polity. And the reality is there has not been majority support for the Conservatives in my lifetime. The last time that the Conservatives won a majority of seats in a UK general election in Scotland was in 1955. The last time that they came close to that was in 1959, and that was with a Prime Minister, Harold Macmillan, who at one point was considering joining the Labour Party, a man who was a One Nation Conservative of a very different variety. And that does raise an interesting point, that word Conservative, Presiding Officer, because the reality is there is much within the Conservative tradition about pragmatic and considered process to reform, about looking to preserve the best of what has come before us and bequeath it to the next generation that many would agree with. But what we have had since 1979 is not a Conservative Party in the tradition of Macmillan or in the tradition even of Churchill, who was also a Liberal, of course. It has been a party of the radical right, engrossed in transatlantic neoliberal politics, which focused solely on the maximisation of profit, and to hell with the consequences, be they social or environmental. Now, there may not be a consensus to address these issues at the UK Parliament. There may not be a consensus to address these issues in UK politics. We may find a situation where a Labour Party seeking office in the United Kingdom constantly finds itself having to triangulate in the hope of attracting Tory voters. But we do not have that problem in Scotland. We have majority support for progressive social democratic politics. We have that broad consensus. And with independence, we can move on from having to mitigate to delivering that better future and that well-being economy that we all want to see. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Minister. That concludes the debate. I would encourage some members to spend their lunchtime refreshing their understanding of speaking through the chair, but for now, and in the meantime, I suspend the meeting until 2:30.